Jerry, we are excited this morning that the Lord is still doing a work across the world and that the Lord is doing a work in Ellisville, Mississippi. Let's stand together as we declare that work. Come, people of the risen King who delight to bring him praise. Let's praise him today. He's given us many reasons this day on the Lord's Day to give him glory. Glory for answered prayer. Glory for changed lives and changed hearts. Glory that he is still making dead men live. Sing this together. Come, people. So many reasons this morning to rejoice as the church of Christ, as the church of the living God in this area, that we can give him the glory that only he deserves. Blessed, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's declare blessings upon his name. Sing it. Amen. Day. Would you be seated where you are?
Good morning. And as we look at our memory verse this week, I've come to you many times this time during our service, and we focus on our memory verse that's found in our rooted journals. And if you're following along in our rooted journals, this is the last week for this quarter. And don't forget that you can pick up your new rooted journal in the Welcome Center before you leave today, because we start a new quarter here the week after next. But our last memory verse for this quarter is found in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And listen to what the word says. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your might. You've heard that one before, haven't you? And that's one that we ought to commit to memory. But this morning, I wanted to use it as a prayer prompt for us as we begin praying and going to the Lord this morning. So let's pray together. Father, we're grateful this morning that we're able to gather. Father, that we're able to gather with our faith family, the people that you have gifted us with as a gift to be able to walk through life together with. And Lord, as we come to your word, the word of old that never changes, Lord, that's never disappointing, God, that is steadfast, true, immutable, never changing. But God, you've encouraged us this morning to love you with all of our hearts. And Father, we know that as reading the scripture here, many times the original audience would have understood that as loving you with all of our minds. And God, this morning we commit ourselves to you with our minds. God, to commit to you, understanding and knowing your word. Father, being ready to give a defense for any time that we have the opportunity to share the good news. But Lord, I pray this morning that we would prepare ourselves. Father, we would prepare ourselves to worship you with our minds. But God, your word also tells us to worship you with all of our soul, every core of our fiber, who we are. Father, may people be able to know that there's something different about us because we've had an interaction with you, Lord, that you have changed our life, that there is a movement taking place in our hearts because we have had this moment in time where we accepted you as Savior and Lord. And Lord, you are changing our life. Father, help us to think about what that means, particularly as we dive into your word this morning. But Lord, you tell us also to worship you with all of our might. That is the physical side of who we are. And God, I pray this morning that you would place upon our heart an area of service and ministry, Lord, that we can physically plug into. God, that we'd be open to where you are leading us to serve you in the most unique of ways. Father, for owning the ministry, Lord, that you've called us to do. Father, may we be faithful in that. God, this morning we are grateful in this country that we live in, Lord, for the reversal of Roe versus Wade. But Lord, that is a day that's been prayed for and prayed for. And Lord, you have heard the cries of your children, and you have literally heard the cries of children. But God, Lord, it's also a starting point for us as a church. Not just talk, but Lord, action. That we would not be just pro-birth, but that we would actually be pro-life. Father, that we would invest in people, that we would love people just like you love people, that we would invest the resources and the time that we need to so that your name may be proclaimed, that people would come to know you, and Father, that they would know that there is a people who love them, and that is your church, your bride. Father, stir our hearts this morning as we continue to sing. Father, as we open up your word and walk through the book of James, may your Holy Spirit apply the truths of your word to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Let's sing that bridge with me. Holy. Sing Jesus, to you we lift our eyes.
Jesus, to you we lift our eyes.
Sing Jesus.
Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our hearts to you.
Jesus, we turn our eyes this morning to you. We behold you, our Savior ever true. We give you the glory that you and you alone deserve, for you are holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. You are worthy of all of our praise. Thank you that you have gathered us in this place today to be under the authority of your word as we worship you, that we would give you the glory truly that you alone deserve. Guide us to your word. Apply it to our lives that we may be obedient to it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen and amen. I don't know about you, but aren't you glad this morning that the air conditioner is working? I was mentioned to several of you, aren't you glad that we're going to have a cool wave coming this week? It's in the low 90s instead of the hundreds this week. So with that being said, I want to start with a little test. I know some of you are on a break from school, but I want to give you a little bit of an agricultural test this morning. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put some pictures of trees up on the screen, and I want you to tell me what type of tree that you see in those pictures. So let's begin with the first one. What kind of tree do you see there? Orange tree, you're doing really good. I'm proud of you. You're making progress. Yes, that's right. That is an orange tree. Maybe this one's a little bit more difficult for you. What is this? Apple tree. Some of you may have thought maybe that's a peach tree a little bit there because the colors are not quite as red as you want to be. Y'all are doing good so far, okay? So far, so good. Let's look at the next one. What is that? That's a lemon tree. Yes. Did my son say peach tree? He's a city boy. That is a lemon tree. So, all right, so most of you are doing pretty good so far. I'm gonna test you a little bit right now. What about this one right here? That is actually an apple tree with no apples. So thinking about that, and I did that for a reason, and the reason that you knew what kind of trees the other ones were because of the fruit that they had on the trees there. The fruit on the outside reveals to us what kind of tree it is on the inside. And so another question that I want to kind of ask you about that is if the tree was dead, would there be any fruit on that tree? Now, there might be some remnants of a piece of fruit on there, but by and large, no, there's not going to be any fruit on those trees. But as soon as you saw those trees, you knew they were alive because of the fruit that you saw on those trees. Now, as we continue walking through the book of James this morning, we're going to discover that if our faith is alive and our faith is genuine, it will spill out of our lives and clearly be evident by the fruit that we produce in our life. Just like when you looked at those trees in those pictures just a moment ago, other people should be able to look at our lives and immediately, without hesitation, know something is alive within us. James is writing here, and what James refers to and what we're going to talk about as fruit, James calls works in this passage. These are works that are demonstrated through our lives, and James is teaching us now about this relationship between faith and works. So James chapter 2, we're going to start reading here in verse 14 in just a minute, and we're going to be looking at those longer passages of scripture. And as we've been studying through this New Testament letter written by the half-brother of Jesus, we see some things, and James is very peculiar and very particular when he confronts us. Last week, just like we did last week, we're going to look at a larger passage of Scripture because James is dealing with one idea in this large section of Scripture, and it's this idea, again, the relationship between faith and works. We're going to read 12 verses here, and in these 12 verses, we're going to see that the word faith is referenced 13 times, either in a noun or a verb form, and the word works is mentioned 11 times. So these verses here are dominated by this relationship between faith and works. Let's pick up in verse 14. He says, "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.' You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see, that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, 'Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God.' You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." And so what I want to do this morning is I want to unpack these verses, and I want to give us two truths, and then I want to end us with a very penetrating question this morning. Here is the first truth that we want to see out of this passage. Faith alone saves. Faith alone saves. Now, this is a major theme in the New Testament particularly in the teachings of the Apostle Paul. When you read in places like Galatians and when you read in the book of Romans, Paul does a major job of teaching on this subject that faith alone saves us. This single truth, faith alone saving us, is so important because it actually is what distinguishes the gospel from every other false gospel and every false religion. And what James is doing here, he's not contradicting that the true faith alone saves. James is reinforcing the truth that faith alone saves. R.C. Sproul, who was a prolific writer in the 20th century, he said this: "The doctrine of justification by faith alone is the article upon which the church stands or falls. The article that is so important that Luther," he's talking about Martin Luther, the great reformer, "said that if we lose it, we lose Christianity. If you don't have the doctrine of justification by faith alone, you don't have the gospel. And if you don't have the gospel, the church has no reason to exist." You see, the way that we come to know God, the way that we are saved, is by faith and faith alone. And that single truth answers the deepest questions of the human heart. How can I know that I am right with a holy God? Everybody in this room, every one of us, we have been to more funerals than we ever wanted to go to in our life. And when you sit in a funeral, you are face to face with the frailty, the brevity of life, and you realize in a moment how quickly life goes, that it doesn't last long, and the questions begin to roll. What happens? What happens after this life? How do I know that I've been accepted by God when this life is over? All of those questions are very real to us. And here's the reality. Every major religion and every false gospel answers this question the same way, and it's in one word. And here's the word in which they answer that question. It's the word "do." Every false gospel, every world religion, you boil it down, the question, how do I know that I am right with God? Here's the way they say, you got to do something. Now, the doing changes depending on the flavor of religion that you are tasting. Maybe it's the five pillars of Islam. Maybe it's the seven sacraments of the Catholic Church. Maybe it's karma that's taught in Eastern thought. Or maybe it's the moral code of conduct that's embraced by so much so-called American Christianity, which is a heresy. But here's the way you answer that question. In any of those world religions or in any false gospel, if you want to know that you are right with God, when it's all over, you got to make sure you do something. And if you don't do all the right stuff and not do all the wrong stuff, you can never know that you are right with God. But the gospel teaches the exact opposite of that. The gospel of Jesus answers this question with one word, and that word is done. That's how it's answered. Everything that's needed to happen in order for you and I to be made right with God has already been done. Already. Listen, it's really not good news if there's something that you got to do. Think about that for just a second. I got myself into this mess. If it's up to me to do the right thing to get myself out of this mess, that's not good news, friends. The word gospel is a word that literally means good news. And that's why when Jesus died on the cross, the last words Jesus spoke were, "It is finished. It's done." Everything that happened needed to happen for you and me to be made right with God was finished when Jesus died on the cross. God loved us so much. He sent His Son to live the life we could not live and die the death that we deserved to die. Christ took the wrath we rightly deserve and He gave us righteousness instead. And the way that we get in on this is simply by faith. Get this. Everything that needed to be done for you to be forgiven, to be accepted by God as His child, has already been done by Jesus for all time. It's already been done. All you and I have to do now is to receive that gift. Let me show it to you where Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 2 and 9, "For by grace you have been saved. You know what grace is, right? Grace is getting what I don't deserve. Grace is God doing for me that which I cannot do on my own. For by grace you've been saved through faith. He's saying, just in case you're not clear, what's the point he's driving on here? He says, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Well, how do you get a gift? You receive it. If you got to do something to get the gift, it stops being a gift. And he says, not as a result of works. There's that word. Works is a word that means something to be done, something you have to do. And Paul says it's all what God's already done by faith. You simply receive it. It has nothing to do with anything you're going to do. Just in case you wanted to get around to boasting, Paul kind of nips it in the bud, as Barney Fife would say, really quickly there. And here's what that means. None of us come strutting into church. None of us come strutting into church. We all got here the same way, by the grace of God. He did for us what we could not do on our own. And that's what James is doing here. Then James not only starts there, he begins to go on and give us an example of Abraham. And James is quoting from the Old Testament book of Genesis when he writes in chapter 2, verse 23 here. He says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, a couple things happen there in that verse. First of all, we see that Abraham believed God. And that's the verb form of the word faith. It's the same root word that is just a verb form to express faith. What did Abraham do? The scripture tells us. He believed. What did he believe? He believed God. You see, there's only one way to be saved from Genesis all the way to the book of Revelation. It's by faith. Now, some people have this mistaken idea that the Old Testament way that people got saved was by keeping the law. And in the New Testament, people are saved by faith. But that's not true. The Bible says here that Abraham in the Old Testament believed God. Now, the difference is Abraham believed looking forward. He looked forward in faith based on the promise that God had made that he was going to send the Messiah. He was going to send someone into the world who's going to reconcile and redeem humanity to God. You and I are today saved by faith by looking back. We're not looking back on just a promise, but we are looking back at a person who came to fulfill that promise. But here's what it also says in verse 23, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, some of your translations say reckoned there instead of the word counted. I actually like the word reckoned a little bit better there. But it's originally not a spiritual word. It was actually an accounting term. It means to credit something to someone's account. The Bible says Abraham, by faith, trusted in the promises of God to send the Messiah into the world. And God did something to his account. He counted. He reckoned something. And here's the reckoning. The act of God whereby he credits Christ's perfect righteousness to sinners' account and declares the debt fully forgiven. I think I'm going to lean on the choir for a response back for that for just a moment. Thank you. The act of God whereby he credits Christ's perfect righteousness to the sinner's account and declares the debt fully forgiven. Amen? Amen? That's the reckoning that took place on the cross when Jesus died. That's what took place. That's what took place. It means that when God came, when we came as a sinner, having rebelled against God, God, when we had stepped across the boundaries, having rejected God's law, God's ways, God's authority, God's sovereignty, when you and I came to God as a sinner, we threw ourselves on the grace and mercy of God. God responded by crediting to our account the righteousness of Christ. So here's what that means. When God looks at your account right now, you know what he sees? Done. It's done. Let me show it to you in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. Paul said, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. On the cross, when Jesus died, he took all of your sin and all of my sin, all of my unworthiness, all of my unholiness, every lustful thought, every wrong word, every angry response. He took it on the cross. And on the cross, Jesus, the one who lived the perfect life that I could not live, that you could not live, Jesus offered his body as a substitute. He took all the junk in my life on himself, and he drank the full cup of the bowl of judgment against God's sin, and he died. But you ready for the good news? He did not stay dead. He did not stay dead. And he rose as a testimony that God had accepted his sacrifice for our sins. That now you and I, by faith, can grab a hold of Jesus. And when we do, what gets credit to us is the righteousness of Christ himself. And here's what that means. When you've been in heaven for 10,000 years, you'll be no more righteous before God than you are right now, because you can't get any more righteous than God himself. And he already sees you clothed in the righteousness of Christ. You say, well, why would God do something like that? This is the mind-blowing part. You ready? Deep theological right here. He loves you. He loves you. Let that sink in for just a moment. Faith alone saves. But here's the second truth that we want to see. Faith that saves is never alone. James is laying on the foundation of other scriptures that teach us justification by faith alone. And there's actually a famous quote in Christian history, and we're really not sure who said it. Some say Martin Luther, some say John Calvin. I'm just going to say that James says it. And it's this quote here. It is faith alone that saves, but the faith that saves is never alone. What do we mean by that? Well, three times in this passage, James is emphasizing this truth. Look back at verse 14 for just a moment. Verse 14 says, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works, can that faith save him there? And what James is saying, how can somebody say, oh, I've got faith, I've got the faith, but there's no evidence, there's no working of that out in faith in their lives? Yes, it is faith alone that saves, but James is saying that faith that saves is never alone. There's something that comes from it. Verse 17 there. So also by its faith by itself, it does not have works, is dead. And then verse 26 there, he says, for as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. That word works that we hear there, there's a lot of baggage there, but it's actually used three times in these verses, and it's also used eight other times throughout this passage of Scripture. That word works that we see there is a word that means something that must be done. Works are the outward, visible evidence of an inward saving faith. Works do not earn our salvation. Works give evidence of our salvation that has been received by grace through faith. Let me take you back to those famous verses by Paul in Ephesians chapter 2 again. He says, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Now, the problem is a lot of Christians stop right here when they're reading this passage of Scripture. They stop. They say, well, I'm good. I'm all good on that right there. But then let's look at the next verse, verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we might walk in them. So what are these works that James and Paul are talking about here? Now, for the sake of time, what I want to do is I want to boil it down to its simplest form this morning. Anything that the Bible would call works or good works or works from salvation or any of those works, you boil it down here, and here's what they are. The life of Jesus and me being lived through me. That's what works are. Faith alone, we know, saves. By faith, we receive the gift of salvation. The gift of salvation means that Christ, by his Spirit, comes to live in us. And what James is teaching is the Christ who lives in us, if our faith is genuine, is now a Christ who will live through us. And it will be evidence in the way that we live our lives. You think about any good work. You boil it down. Here's what the life of Jesus and me being, is the life of Jesus being lived through me. That's what it is. Now, to make this as practical as I can, I want to give you three defining statements about faith and works. And here's the first. It is through faith alone that I've been saved. Now, we've already unpacked this. That was the first point, whole first point of the message. Faith alone saves. It's through faith alone that I have been saved. But here's the second statement. Being saved by faith means God is now changing me. Salvation is not a moment. Salvation is a movement. It's a movement of God that begins in your life at the moment of faith and works in your life into eternity, where God is at work conforming us into the image of Jesus. A faith that saves us is a faith that changes us as we begin to be conformed into the image of Christ. Let me show you to you in 2 Corinthians 3:18. Paul writes this, "And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another." Now, is that something that's finished or still happening? It's still happening. It's present active. It's a continuous action. Now, what was done is at the moment of salvation, when I put my faith in Christ positionally before God, I'm saved and you're saved. I'm righteous before God as I'm ever going to be. But before others, God is still working out in my life practically the righteousness that is mine positionally as I'm being transformed into the same image of Jesus from one degree of glory to another. That word transformed that we see there is not a completely unfamiliar word to us in the English. It's the word metamorphosis. It describes an inward change that is outwardly visible. It's the old illustration of the caterpillar turning into the butterfly. But here's the good news. It's something that God is going to finish. He's going to finish. He told us in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." God is going to finish what he started. One day, the stuff that we deal with right now, we won't have to deal with anymore because he will finish what he started. And here's what that means. Salvation is not you and I working hard to change our lives. Salvation is God at work in and through us. Our union with Christ is conforming us to his image, and works are the outward visible expression or evidence of the change that God is making in our lives day to day. And the point that James is driving home is this: if there is no evidence of faith, it's not genuine. It's not true. Which leads us to the third point I want to make, but it's the penetrating question that I want to ask you. Our third point of that statement, let me go back. Works are the change in me spilling out of me that allows others to know my faith is real. And so when James refers to us being justified by works, it's not just justified before God. We've already been justified before God the moment we put our faith and our trust in Jesus. The justification now that James is talking about is a justification that is in front of my brothers and sisters in Christ in the world that's watching me. If you remember back to our Centered Life series, we talked about know, live, and share, knowing God personally, daily, and intimately, and allowing that to overflow in how I live my life with my other brothers and sisters in Christ. That's what we're talking about here. Now, in one sense, It's going to look different in every one of our lives because think about it for just a moment. We're all at different places in the process. Some of us are further along than others. Some of us just came to Christ. You're just getting started. And some of you have been walking with Jesus for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years. So we're at different places in the process. It's going to look different for all of us. But here's what it's going to look like, though. You ready? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's what it's going to look like. What is that? That's a nine-dimensional configuration of the person of Jesus Christ. It's different, meaning that I can't look at somebody else and think that I've arrived because I'm further along in the journey than they are. Or look at somebody else and get all guilty about where I am because they're further along than I am. No, we're all in different places in this process right now. We ought to, though, begin to smell the same, though. Now, that seemed kind of weird, but that's the best way I could lay it out to you. We may not all look the same, but we ought to start smelling the same. That was a bad illustration, wasn't it? But you know what I'm talking about, don't you? We're all using the same soap. But he gives us an example. Go back to verse 15 for just a moment. He says, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm and filled, without giving them the things needed for their body, what good is that? Now, you got to know some things about these phrases here. That phrase, first of all, go in peace, it would have been a familiar Jewish form of dismissal. It's really a way to say, have a nice day. That's kind of what he's saying there. Or this phrase, be warmed and filled. In the original language, those are either middle or passive verbs, meaning this. It's either saying, go and warm and feed yourself, and that's the middle voice. I'm a Christian, my faith is in Jesus, and my brother and sister is in need. And I say, have a good day, go fix your own problems. Or it's in the passive voice, go find somebody else to do that for you. If, in case you haven't picked up on the sarcasm there, James is criticizing folks. He's criticizing the church. If you say that you have faith and you have a brother or sister in need and you tell them to have a nice day and go find someone else to help you meet that need, James is saying your faith is dead. It is not real. If faith has no works, your faith is fake. So where did James get this idea from? Did he just make this up? Well, his half-brother Jesus is quoted in John, 1 John chapter 3, verse 17. John quotes Jesus, but if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Now, we hadn't even got to the part yet of how God has called us to reach the people who do not know him out there. Jesus is just now, he's specifically talking to us about how we relate to one another who are in the family, specifically in the context of a faith family. James and John are joining the circle real narrow right now, and we're going to deepen it, and we're going to make it deeper here in a little while, in a couple of weeks, in the world that we have to serve. But John asks us a rhetorical question in this passage. And James goes on and he gives us a couple of examples of Abraham, and he gives us an example of Rahab. Two very different stories, two very different backgrounds, but there's a similarity though. And the similarity is this: both of them possessed a faith that you could see in their lives that they lived. So faith alone saves. Faith that saves is never alone. But here is the probing question, the penetrating question that I want to ask us this morning as we get ready to close. Do you have saving faith? Something was happening for James to write this. Something was happening in the church. There was a lot of people in the early church who were saying, oh, I believe, I put my faith in Jesus, but there was no evidence whatsoever. There was no change. There was no Christ being lived out through them. And James is, he's challenging that. And if there's ever been a moment for the church in America to listen to the words of the book of James, it's now. We have a profession of faith with our lips that is not evident in the lives that we live. And our communities and the world are watching, and they want nothing to do with this. James lands on a verse of scripture here in verse 19. He says, you believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. And so what do we learn here in that verse? First of all, the faith that saves is not merely an intellectual faith. He said, look, you believe that God is one. You do well. Even demons believe that. Intellectual faith is accepting a historical Jesus. I believe that Jesus is God's son. I believe that Jesus died on the cross. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I believe that Jesus is coming again. I believe Jesus is a miracle worker. I believe all of that. James says, listen, so does every demon in hell. They intellectually knew that. True saving faith is not only just not an intellectual faith, but it's also not just an emotional faith. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe. And then he says, and they shudder. That word shudder is a word that literally describes the hair standing up on the back of your neck. The demons not only intellectually accepted who Jesus is, they had an emotional response to who Jesus was. And the Church of America is full of people who would give intellectual assent to who Jesus is and have every emotion stirred up over who Jesus is, just like every demon. There are some who go to these events and they get all fired up. They check a box and nothing changes. It's an emotional faith. Faith that saves is not just intellectual faith. It's not just emotional faith. It is faith that is real. There is a heart transformation with this faith. There is a desire in us that is surrendering the control of our lives. And that's what the demons didn't do. They never surrendered to Jesus. The difference in intellectual, the emotional, is when we get to the place of surrendering our lives to Christ. In the 19th century, there was a famous French acrobat known all over the world by his stage name, and his name was Charles Blondin. And Blondin performed feats of acrobatics all over the world, and he was acclaimed internationally through the newspapers and magazines of the time. And one day, he makes the announcement that he's going to do the greatest feat that he's ever set out to accomplish. He's going to make a tightrope running about 1,100 feet all the way across Niagara Falls. And with no harnesses and no safety nets, no ropes, he was going to walk across Niagara Falls on a tightrope. And when the announcement was made, people showed up by the thousands on both the Canadian and the American sides of Niagara Falls to watch Blondin do his thing. And he had a pole in his hand to balance as he began to walk. I've got a picture for you up this morning. Here he is. And he begins to walk across Niagara Falls, and the crowd literally holds their breath. In celebration and applause that Blondin had completed this unbelievable feat. But he wasn't satisfied. He did it again, and this time he pushed a wheelbarrow all the way to the middle. He turned around and he came back. Dummy. And they erupted again. But he wasn't satisfied. He went back to the middle, and this time he took a skillet of sort. He cooks an omelet in the middle of this, eats the omelet, and he comes back strutting all the way over Niagara Falls. And as he comes across Niagara Falls, the crowd is just shouting. They're going crazy. But still, he wasn't satisfied. So he takes his manager, and he puts his manager on his back, and he did it again, and the fourth time across Niagara Falls. Can you imagine how every step, everybody was watching, they were on edges. And when he got to that last step, he stepped up again, and the crowds just lost their mind. Then Blondin turned to the crowds, and he says, how many of you think that I can do it again? And everyone cheered. We believe. Emotionally, they had been moved, and they were stirred. And Blondin looked at the crowd and says, okay, who wants to get on my back? Crickets. Nobody. Why do I tell us that story? You believe in Jesus? I believe. Do you believe in the cross? I believe. Do you believe that he rose from the dead? I believe. Do you believe he's the only one to be saved? I believe. Here's what James says. Even demons believe that. Here's the deal. When you get on,
You give up control. Saving faith is a surrender of control of my life to Jesus that then begins to be evidenced through my life by works. And that's what James is teaching us here, the relationship between faith and works. So here is the question that I leave you with today. Do you have saving faith? Father, thank you this morning that you have offered salvation to us through your Son. Father, in this moment that we have together, Father, I pray that your Spirit is moving in a way that's life-changing for someone here. For some of us here in this room, we've played a good game. We've said all the right things. But Lord, we've never come to the point where we've surrendered control of our lives to you, and it shows. Our faith is dead. There is no evidence of a surrendering of control. And Father, today I pray that as you continue to draw us to yourself, Father, that we would have the courage to trust you with our life. Understanding that when we trust you with our life, Father, you begin to do things in our life, Lord, that we could never imagine. Father, we live life as you intended it to live. Our faith is real. It's no longer fake. And God, I pray that you give us the courage in this moment to step out in faith and to trust you. God, we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Friends, if you're here today and that's you, you realize this morning through looking and diving into God's word that your faith is not real. You've had a mask on and you've said all the right things, but you've never surrendered your life to Jesus. Today, I want to encourage you to do that, because it's not until you surrendered your life to Jesus does your faith begin to change who you are. You see, when Jesus died on the cross, we were saved at that moment when we put our faith and our trust in him, but God is still working on us. And for you who are believers here today, I want to encourage you to surrender your life. So many times in our life, we want to hold things back. We want to do things my way. And that is just our way of playing God, thinking that we know better than everybody else and know better than God particularly. But that doesn't work, friends. It only leads to frustration and disappointment in life. I want to challenge you this morning to surrender it all to Jesus. We're going to sing a hymn of response this morning. And if the Lord is working on your heart and you need to respond this morning, I'll be standing right here. I'd love to pray for you. Or you can spend time on these altars. Whatever the Lord is leading you to do, you do that this morning. Let's stand and let's sing.
All right. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've moved him o'er and o'er, Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for
this service, baptizing one who has come in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is Christina Alba. Christina has come to us requesting baptism. She was baptized as an infant in the Catholic Church, but recently came to faith in Christ and knew if she was going to be obedient to the call of Scripture, she wanted to be baptized as a believer. She has testified publicly to her repentance and her faith in Christ, and she's demonstrated since that faith the works, the fruit of that repentance and faith. Christina, have you repented of your sin?
Yes.
Do you believe Jesus is Lord?
Yes.
Do you believe God raised him from the dead?
Yes.
Christina, the Lord gave you and your family to us as friends a long, long time ago. But I am so grateful that today I can baptize you in the name of as my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen.
What a beautiful picture of a faith that transforms. And I always say this, and Pastor Robert nailed it here. I hope that as you see someone else publicly profess their faith in Jesus Christ, that it reminds you of a couple of things. One, if you have put your faith and trust in Christ, the simple gospel message that God can change lives is available to you, and you've experienced that. But if you're here today and you've never experienced that in life, then today would be a day that you begin to ask yourself some questions. One, is my faith a saving faith? And Christina has demonstrated that to us, and I am grateful that she's with us to journey with us. And God, we are grateful for that, for her family with us today. We're so thankful for that. I'm glad that you guys are here today. But we're also glad that you're here today. And if you're a guest with us, we're extremely glad that you're here. And if you have in front of you the connection card, if you're a guest with us, if you'll fill that out and drop it in one of our offering boxes before you leave, we greatly appreciate that. A couple things to remind you of before announcements, as you can tell my microphone was dead, so I'm having to scream a little bit here, but we'll get it done. Tonight is our movie night. We're going to watch The Prince of Egypt at 5 o'clock over at the Family Life Center. We'll have hot dogs, hamburgers, popcorn, all those things. I want you to join us at 5 o'clock this evening over in the FLC. Also, you see there an old-fashioned Sunday scene. Sunday, that's a mouthful. Old-fashioned Sunday scene on July the 24th, 5 o'clock. So we've got some great times of fellowship coming up this summer. Two other things, as I mentioned already, the third quarter Rudy Journals, you can pick those up over in our Next Step Center. And you can get those for $2 is what they cost. And then also, if you are interested in helping us with our bus ministry, we have a nice bus that's over there in the bus barn, but we have very few people who can actually drive it. So what happens is it collects dust, and we don't want that to happen. And so if you are interested in helping with our bus ministry, if you're interested in getting your CDL or Class B CDL, please see me. We've got a system worked out where we're going to try to get that done for as many people as we can at one time. And so please see me before you leave today. So let's stand together and I'm going to pray for us. And we're going to be dismissed here. We're going to take about a 5-minute break and then we'll have our first family meeting. Lord, thank you for the day. Thank you for Christina and her public profession of faith this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you are still saving lives. God, we are grateful this morning for the faith that we have through Jesus. Father, I pray that as we continue to walk each and every day, as we surrender our life to you, Father, that faith would be demonstrated by our works, that people would know that we are followers of Jesus by the things that we say and by the things that we do. And Lord, we pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Can't bring your fame.